Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salli wa sallimu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, nabiyyina wa habibina wa qurrati a'yunina Muhammad ibn Abdillah. Alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi afdalu salati wa atammu taslim. Amma ba'd. As always, we begin by praising Allah Jalla wa Az. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I would like to begin by reminding ourselves that we are not supposed to ever lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mercy of Allah azza wa jal is ever encompassing, and He clearly states this in many places in the noble Quran. Inna Allaha ghafuru rahim. And we ourselves, every time we open up the Quran, what do we say? We say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. Inna Allaha ghafuru rahim. Indeed, Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. At times, some of us, we feel that we are so engulfed in sin that we think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not forgive us, or we think that we are too evil to be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bear in mind that for that specific thought of yours where you have lost hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have given up on Allah azza wa jal, for that particular thought you need a separate tawbah for that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving, the most merciful. He is just waiting for us to turn to Him. So it is us, we need to take the initiative, we need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the minute we do, if we do it sincerely, if we turn to Him in sincere tawbah, no doubt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us. Famous hadith of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, which has been recorded in the book of Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim rahimahum Allah. The narration goes along the lines of these words. There was once a man who killed 99 individuals. Now after killing, basically he's a serial killer. He has killed 99 individuals. And after killing 99 individuals, you know, he wants to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wants to seek the forgiveness of Allah azza wa jal. It's not some fairy tale. These are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He does not speak out of his own desires, but he speaks his divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is an authentic hadith recorded in Bukhari and Muslim. This man wants to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He goes by a priest. He goes to this particular monk and he asks him, I want to turn to God. I want to seek forgiveness. Do you think God will forgive me? Do you think God will forgive me? The monk looks at him and says, you have killed 99 individuals. You have killed 99 individuals. There can be no forgiveness for you whatsoever. This enraged the man and he killed the monk, totaling the number of individuals to 100. Now he has killed 100 individuals. Now what he does is he goes to a scholar, an individual who has knowledge, and he asks this individual, you know, I have killed 100 people. Do you think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me? Do you think there is forgiveness for me? The scholar looks at him and says, of course, why not? Who are we to judge you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the best of judges. It is between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you need to take the initiative. But now that the sincere intention has come in your heart, leave this land, because this land is evil for you. This is the land of sin for you. Leave this land and travel to so and so, this particular land. There are individuals there. They are righteous individuals. There are righteous individuals in that particular land. They worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go and join them and seek forgiveness. Turn over a new leaf and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with them. Leave this land and go to that group of individuals. When you look at the conditions of tawbah, the first condition is nadhim. You must regret all of your sins. You must sincerely, deeply regret. Number two is al-iqla'. You must come out of the sin. And this is what the scholar instructed this individual to do. Leave this land. This land is evil for you. This land is a land of sin. Leave it. You need to completely come out of the sin that you are in. Al-Iqla. The third condition, Al-Azm. You must have firm determination that you will not come back to that sin again. You must have firm determination that you will not commit those sins that you used to commit in the past. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to turn to Him in sincere tawbah. So the man, he agrees and now he begins his journey. He undertakes the journey. He leaves this evil land and he moves. The evil land, it's evil for him, like I said, because he had committed so many sins there. He leaves the land and now he's headed towards this group of righteous individuals. Halfway through the journey, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed that he should pass away and the angel of death takes his soul. Now what happens is that the angels of mercy come down to take his soul and the angels of azab, torment and punishment, they come down as well to take his soul. And now there is a dispute, breaks out between the angels of mercy and the angels of azab. The angels of mercy say he has made tawbah, he has made sincere tawbah and that is manifesting itself. He is proving it by this journey of his. He has undertaken a journey and he's headed to meet a group of righteous individuals and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with them. So this proves that he has made sincere tawbah. So we need to take his soul. The angels of azab, they state, no, he was a serial killer and he has killed 100 people. He deserves to be punished and we need to take his soul. So there was a dispute between the two groups of angels. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down another angel to mediate between the two groups. This angel comes down and tells the two groups, why don't you do this? Why don't you measure the land? Okay? And if you find him closer to the land of sin, then let the angels of azab take his soul. But on the other hand, if you find him close to the land of goodness, then let the angels of mercy take his soul. Both parties agree and they measure the land. They find this individual closer to the land of goodness and the angels of mercy take his soul. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, scholars rahimahumullah, they write, they mention in regard to the explanation of this hadith that there could have been a possibility, because he had just undertaken the journey, there could have been a possibility that this individual in reality could have been closer to the land of sin. But out of the infinite mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He Azza wa Jal rolled up the land and made this slave of his closer to the land of mercy. This, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is indeed forgiving and most merciful. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that narration goes along the lines of these words, that just picture a man traveling across a barren desert. He has got his mode of conveyance, say a horse or camel or whatever with him. He's got all of his provisions laden on that animal, okay? And he is crossing a desert. Halfway through, he loses this animal. Now, the animal is his mode of conveyance, okay? Mode of transport. All of his provisions, food, water, everything, all of the provisions that he needs for the journey has been laden on the animal, and he loses the animal. Just imagine how grief struck that individual would be. Just put yourselves in the shoes of that individual. I need you to picture yourself there. How would you feel in the middle of a barren, dry desert and you've lost your animal, you've lost all of your provisions, you're all alone. Now what will be, you know, there'll be a turmoil of emotions going through your mind, right? So this man, he loses all hope, sits down and takes a rest. He falls asleep. He falls asleep in that, you know, sad train of thought. He falls asleep. When he gets up, when he wakes up, he finds the animal beside him with all of the provisions, everything there. Just imagine how happy that man would be. What do you think? The man would be so happy. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say that Allah Azza wa Jal is more happier than that man when a slave of his turns to him seeking forgiveness in sincere tawbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more happier than that individual. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above all examples. We can't quote examples to compare Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but this is the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is for our weak minds to comprehend. These are for our, these examples are for our weak minds to comprehend, for us to understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more happier than a man who loses everything and then finds it in the middle of a desert. Allahu Akbar. This, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So do not ever lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. Turn to Him before it's too late. And no doubt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you of your sins. Inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bihi wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. Indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins except for shirk. And even shirk, as long as you don't die on shirk, even shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you if you turn to Him before you die. But if you die upon shirk, then you have no forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not stand a chance to attain the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But on the other hand, even shirk, if you turn to Allah before you die, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. May Allah azza wa jal forgive all of our sins. Ameen. Now we go back to the stories of the prophets alayhi salatu wasalam. Where did we stop yesterday? Yes? Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. We mentioned that there were 8 to 10 qurun between Adam alayhi salatu wasalam and Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. 8 to 10 qurun. And we also said that a qurun can be translated, if you translate it in today's context, it can be directly translated as a century, which is 100 years. But then the word qarn can also be translated as a millennium, which is 1,000 years, and it can also be translated as jil, a generation. And then we also said that the more favorable opinion is that either it is that there were 8 to 10 millenniums, or that there were 8 to 10 generations between Adam alayhi salatu wasalam and Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. 8 to 10 generations. And we also spoke about the full name of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, and you saw how he goes back to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. We also discussed the struggle of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam for a 950 years. Since his appointment as a prophet, he struggled with his qawm, with his nation, inviting them and calling them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also discussed about the obstinate, stubborn and arrogant response of his people, where towards the end they asked him to bring on the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he faced obstacles, so many obstacles from different aspects. He faced so many obstacles. Like we mentioned yesterday, his own wife and son did not accept the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His own wife and son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in Surah Al-Tahrim. ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا امْرَأَةَ نُوحٍ وَامْرَأَةَ لُوطٍ كَانَتَا تَحْتَ عَبْدَيْنِ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا صَالِحَيْنِ فَخَانَتَاهُمَا فَلَمْ يُغْنِيَا عَنْهُمَا مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَقِيلَ ادْخُلَا النَّارَ مَعَ الدَّاخِلِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets forth an example for those who disbelieve. ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And who are the examples? إِمْرَأَةَ نُوح وَامْرَأَةَ لُوت. The wife of Nooh and the wife of Lut عليهما الصلاة والسلام. كَانَتَا تَحْتَ عَبْدَيْنِ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. They were under two of our righteous slaves. These two women were under two of our righteous slaves, Nooh and Lut عليهما الصلاة والسلام. مِنْ عِبَادِنَا صَالِحَيْنِ. فَخَانَتَاهُمَا. And they both betrayed their husbands. Now how did they betray their husbands? Are we talking about betrayal in terms of marriage, in terms of a marital relationship? Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he mentions in his book Aqidatul Wasitiyah that no individual, no believer ever has the right to accuse any wife. In the sense, a believer does not have the right at all to accuse a wife of any prophet from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Not just Aisha radiallahu anha, as it happened during the incident of Ifk, where they accused her radiallahu anha, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. He goes on to say that it is not permissible for a believer to accuse any prophet's wife alayhim salatu wasalam. It is not permissible at all. And if an individual does accuse a wife of any prophet from the prophets of Allah alayhim salatu wasalam, he has committed kufr. He has committed kufr. So this particular ayah, فَخَانَتَهُمَا, we don't say that they betrayed their husbands in terms of their marital relationships, in terms of their marriages, but instead, فَخَانَتَهُمَا, they betrayed them by not accepting the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They betrayed their husbands by not accepting the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَمْ يُغْنِيَا عَنْهُمَا مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا and وَقِيلَ دُخُلَ النَّارَ مَعَ الدَّاخِلِينَ and it was said to them, enter the fire, it will be said to them, وَقِيلَ دُخُلَ النَّارَ مَعَ الدَّاخِلِينَ enter the fire with those who enter the fire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from the blazing fire of Jahannam. So we mentioned that the people of Nooh was so stubborn and arrogant in denying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They denied Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam so much to the extent that when they were on their deathbeds, they used to advise their children. They used to make wasiyah. It was part of their final testament, their last will. They used to advise their children, don't be fooled by Nooh. Don't follow Nooh. Don't ever follow Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. And you should inform your children as well that they should not follow Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. These were the people of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. Then we also mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed unto Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam after a period of time, after his struggle of 950 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed unto him that the doors of Tawbah were now closed. The ones who have believed, no one else is going to believe. فَلَا تَبْتَئِسْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ do not grieve over what they will do, the people of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. And then we also, towards the end of the previous session, we mentioned that Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays now against his nation. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays against his nation and he says, وَقَالَ نُوحُ رَبِّ لَا تَذَرْ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِهِنَ دَيَّارًا Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays, O my Lord, leave not even one of the disbelievers on earth. Don't even leave one of the disbelievers on earth. إِنَّكَ إِن تَذَرْهُمْ يُضِلُّ عِبَادَكَ If you leave them, what will they do? They will mislead your slaves. وَلَا يَلِدُ إِلَّا فَاجِرًا كَفَارًا And they will beget none but wicked disbelievers. They will only reproduce more disbelievers. So don't even leave one of them on the face of this earth. And then Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam prays, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِمَنْ دَخَلَ بَيْتِيَ مُؤْمِنًا وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَلَا تَزِدِ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا تَبَارًا Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he prays, My Lord, forgive me, forgive my parents, and forgive the one who enters my home as a believer. وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ And all the believing men and women. وَلَا تَزِدِ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا تَبَارًا And to the ظَالِمُون, to the wrongdoers, the disbelievers, do not grant them anything in increase but destruction. Destroy them. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, now we continue the story. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the King of all kings, He answers the dua of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, and He instructs Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam to build a ship. وَاصْنَعِ الْفُلْكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا وَوَحِيْنَا Build a ship, O Nooh, under our eyes. وَاصْنَعِ الْفُلْكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا وَوَحِيْنَا And by our inspiration. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and when my punishment comes down, وَلَا تُخَاطِبْنِي فِي الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِنَّهُمْ مُغْرَقُونَ Do not intercede on behalf of any of them. You have made the dua, now build the ship, and when my punishment comes down, do not ever intercede on behalf of any of them. Innahum mughraqoon. They are all going to be drowned. Allahu Akbar. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals unto Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam to start growing trees. To start growing trees. For what purpose? Because the lands of Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam, where he came from, where his people were, was a rocky, barren land. A mix of a desert and rocky, barren land. So, as we will discuss soon inshallah, the people also used to make fun and they used to mock Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam. Why on earth are you building a huge ship in the middle of a desert, in the middle of rocky, barren lands where there is not even a drop of water in sight? Where is the ship of yours going to go? Is it going to grow a pair of legs and walk? Where is it going to go? Why are you building a ship in the middle of nowhere? So now to build this ship, Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam, he needed what? He needed wood. He needed wood. So he was instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grow trees. And the books of history mention that he cultivated trees to build this huge and massive ship for almost a century. He cultivated trees for almost 100 years. He cultivated trees for almost 100 years. And now the ship was being built, like we said, in the middle of a desert. Books of history mention that the length of the ship was 300 arms length. Now that's around 700 to 800 feet. I don't want to lose you all. So just to put things in perspective, let's strike a comparison between a somewhat modern day ship. In comparison, I'm sure most of you all have heard about the Titanic. The Titanic was 800 odd feet in length. 800 odd feet in length. So the ship of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was also built approximately around 700 to 800 feet in length. Its width, the ship of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, its width was 50 arms length, which is around 120 to 200 feet, give or take. The Titanic's breadth, on the other hand, was only 90 odd feet. The breadth, the width of the ship. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's ship was 120 to 200 feet. The height of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's ship, the height, we spoke about the length, breadth, we're talking about the height. The height of the ship of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was around 100 feet. Was around 100 feet. The Titanic was also around 90 odd feet in terms of the height. So I gave you this comparison to give you a rough idea of the dimensions of the ship of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Because at times, you know, we watch certain cartoons, we read books, and we think, you know, there's a tiny little ship bobbing around in the ocean. No, it was a huge ship, a huge and massive ship that Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam built. You can, when I gave you the dimensions, I'm sure you must be having a good picture of the size of the ship by now. It was a huge and massive ship that Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam built. The ship was made of planks of wood and iron. The ship was made of planks of wood and iron, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, وَحَمَلْنَاهُ عَلَىٰ ذَاتِ أَلْوَاحٍ وَدُسُرٍ. And we carried Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam on a ship, وَحَمَلْنَاهُ, we carried him, عَلَىٰ ذَاتِ أَلْوَاحٍ وَدُسُرٍ, upon a ship made of planks, wooden planks, and iron nails. Iron nails. So the ship was made of wood and iron. So after building the ship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it took a very long period to build the ship as well. He cultivated trees for almost 100 years, and it took some time to build the ship as well. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him to build three decks upon the ship. Three decks. On any ship you have decks. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to build three decks on that ship. The lowest deck was for animals, for the beasts and animals. The deck above that, that's the middle deck, was for the human beings, passengers. And the topmost deck was for the birds. Tuyur was for the birds. And above that, a roof was built to shelter them all. It was a huge ship with three decks and a roof above it to shelter them all. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam to take aboard a pair of every animal. Of every animal, a pair, male and female. And he was commanded to stock the ship with all kinds of provision and food to last the period where the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to descend. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam to ask the believers, the few believers that were with him, to board the ship as well. Now whilst Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam was building the ship, like I said earlier, the people started to mock him and they started to jeer at him. They started to make fun of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions this in the Noble Quran.
وَيَصْنَعُ الْفُلْكَ وَكُلَّمَا مَرَّ عَلَيْهِ مَلَأٌ مِّن قَوْمِهِ سَخِرُوا مِنْهِ.
And as Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam was constructing the ship, وَكُلَّمَا مَرَّ عَلَيْهِ مَلَأٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ. And whenever the chiefs of his people passed by him, the chiefs of the qawm, the nation of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, passed by him, سَخِرُوا مِنْ. They used to make fun of him, they used to mock him, they used to jeer, they used to call him names. قَالَ. And then, قَالَ إِن تَسْخَرُوا مِنَّا فَإِنَّا نَسْخَرُوا مِنْكُمْ كَمَا تَسْخَرُونَ. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, very calmly he used to reply, إِن تَسْخَرُوا مِنَّا, if you mock at us, فَإِنَّا نَسْخَرُوا مِنْكُمْ, so do we mock at you, كَمَا تَسْخَرُونَ, likewise for your mocking. There'll be a time that will come, you're mocking me now, but when the time comes, when the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes, we will mock at you just as how you used to mock us. Allahu Akbar. فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ يَأْتِيهِ عَذَابٌ يُخْزِيهِ وَيَحِلُّ عَلَيْهِ عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ. And you will know who it is on whom the punishment will come upon, the punishment that will cover him with disgrace, and upon whom will fall a lasting punishment, a lasting torment. Allahu Akbar. These were the calm replies of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam to his people. Now, after the ship was built, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَدَعَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَغْلُوبٌ فَانْتَصِرْ. He invokes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying, Ya Allah, because even whilst he was building the ship, they didn't think of, oh, the promise of Allah is going to come. They did not think of even trying to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though the doors of Tawbah were closed shut. Instead, they kept mocking Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. They kept making fun of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. So he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَدَعَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَغْلُوبٌ فَانْتَصِرْ. He invokes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying, Ya Allah, I have been overcome. إِنِّي مَغْلُوبٌ. I have been overcome. فَانْتَصِرْ. So help me, Ya Allah. Help me. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it in the Noble Quran.
حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَمْرُنَا وَفَارَتَ النُّورُ.
And then, it was till then, there came our command, وَفَارَتْ تَنُّورُ, and the tanur gushed forth water. We will translate that soon, inshallah.
قُلْ نَحْمِلْ فِيهَا مِنْ كُلِّ زَوْجَيْنِ اثْنَيْنِ وَأَهْلَكَ إِلَّا مَنْ سَبَقَ عَلَيْهِ الْقَوْلُ وَمَنْ آمَنَ وَمَا آمَنَ مَعَهُ إِلَّا خَلِيلٌ.
And then we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we said to Nooh, we said to the people of Nooh, the believers, embark therein, embark the ship, of each kind, two, a pair, male and female. And Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, you and your family, illa man sabaqa alayhi al-qawl, except for those whom the word has already gone forth. In other words, the ones who have already disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they cannot enter. But the believers, including your family, yourself, and all of the animals, beasts, and birds, all should enter in pairs, male and female.
وَمَا آمَنَ مَعَهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and none believed with Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam or in Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam except for a few individuals. There were only a few believers with Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam. Now very swiftly in regard to the family of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he had three sons. I'm sorry, he had four sons. The fourth one did not believe in him. I'm talking about the three sons who were believers. They were Sam, Ham and Yafith. Sam, known as Shem in the books of Torah and Injil. Ham, and Yafith, who was known as Japheth. Yafith was known as Japheth. The three sons, Sam, Ham, and Yafith. The fourth son who did not believe in Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, his name was Yam or Kan'an. Yam or Kan'an. And his wife, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam's wife, did not join him as well. These were the two individuals. His son, his fourth son Yam, as well as his wife, did not join him aboard the ship. Now the believers all boarded the ship with Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, and the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gripped this planet. Now you need to understand that it was not just one particular, one island, or one country, or one continent that was affected. No. You need to understand the magnitude of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The command of Allah azza wa jal gripped the whole planet. The whole planet. And water started to gush out from every crack and crevice. From every place water started to gush out. Now in regard to the ayah I recited earlier, in regard to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَثَارَ التَّنُّورِ. Now التَّنُّور can be translated as an oven. التَّنُّور can be translated as an oven. So if you were to directly translate the ayah, the ovens, you know the ovens where you bake bread, the ovens gushed water out. In other words, water gushed out from the ovens. وَثَارَ التَّنُّورِ. So scholars rahimahumullah explain this ayah. We have a couple of explanations. One is that wherever they had ovens, the ayah states that even from the ovens, what comes out of an oven in general? Heat and fire. But even from the ovens, water gushed out from their homes. Wherever they had ovens, you generally have an oven in the midst of your house. So even from their homes, water gushed out. This is one explanation. It goes with the literal translation of the ayah. Another explanation is that if you look at planet Earth, if you look at planet Earth, it consists of cores, the planet. You have the crust, which is the top layer, and then you have an upper mantle, you have a lower mantle, then you have an outer core, and right in the middle you have the inner core, which consists of something known as magma, which is hot liquid iron. Hot liquid iron, something like molten lava, so hot. I'm sure you might have seen the diagrams of the planet, you know, from within. You'll see the different layers, and right in the middle there'll be like a fiery, blazing ball of heat. That is known as the core of the planet. And scientists state that they have conducted experiments, and that core is so hot that it is at a hellish 6,000 degrees Celsius of heat. It's so hot. So scholars state that وَثَارَ التَّنُّورِ, water gushed out from the oven of the planet, i.e. from the core of the planet. So you can just imagine how much of water gushed out. It covered the whole planet. It engulfed the whole planet. It basically drowned every single thing on the face of this earth. So much of water gushed out from this earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also states, فَفَتَحْنَا أَبْوَابَ السَّمَاءِ بِمَاءٍ مُنْهَمِرٍ. And we opened the gates of the heavens, and water gushed forth. The heavens were cleft asunder, and water started to pour down. وَفَجَّرْنَا الْأَرْضَ عُيُونًا. And we caused the earth to gush forth with springs of water. فَالْتَقَى الْمَاءُ. The waters of the heaven and the waters of the earth, they met. You have heavy water coming from the heavens and water gushing out from the earth. So much of water. It was a huge storm that took place. فَالْتَقَى الْمَاءُ عَلَىٰ أَمْرٍ قَدْ قُدِرٍ. And the two waters, in other words, the waters of the heaven and the waters of the earth, met for a matter predestined. These were all, now this is a very important point. عَلَىٰ أَمْرٍ قَدْ قُدِرٍ. It was for a matter that has already been predestined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when was this destined by Allah azza wa jal? 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. It was decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this will take place. This will take place. It was decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the whole planet was engulfed with water. The water level was reaching now the peaks of mountains. Allahu Akbar. You see, I mean, you have records of the tallest of waves. Tallest of waves. And when you look at the surveys that have been conducted, they are about 100 to 150 feet. But then the Quran ayah that we will recite in a few moments inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states that the وَهِيَ تَجْرِي بِهِمْ فِي مَوْجٍ كَالْجِبَالِ. The ship now was floating around in the water, and it was being battered by waves like mountains, like the height of mountains. What's the height of Mount Everest? Almost around 20,000 odd feet. The tallest wave that has been recorded in recent history is somewhere around 100 to 150 feet. It's tiny in comparison to the mountains. But on that day, there were waves equivalent to the mountains. There were such huge waves that were battering the ship around, turning the ship around, and the ship was floating in the midst of all of this. At this point, something very emotional happens. Nooh alayhi salatu wa salam, he sees his son floundering in the water. Which son was this? Yam, as we mentioned, Yam or Kanaan. The minute he saw his son, Nooh alayhi salatu wa salam, his family, the three sons who believed in him, the other believers, they were all safely aboard the ship. He sees his son floundering in the water, and fatherly affection grips him, and he cries out to his son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, وَهِيَ تَجْرِي بِهِمْ فِي مَوْجٍ كَالْجِبَالِ وَنَادَى نُوحٌ ابْنَهُ وَكَانَ فِي مَعْزِلٍ يَا بُنَيَّ ارْكَمْ مَعَنَا وَلَا تَكُمْ مَعَ الْغَافِلِينَ. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, the ship, in other words, was sailing with them, with the believers, amidst the waves like mountains, as we just mentioned. And Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, وَنَادَى نُوحٌ إِبْنَهُ. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he spots his son and he cries out to him, وَكَانَ فِي مَعْزِلِ. The son who had separated himself apart from them, he cries out to him. This son, we just mentioned, his name was Yam or Kana'an. يَا بُنَي. Look at this affectionate plea. Oh my beloved son, Ya Bunay, oh my dear son, irkam ma'ana wa la takum ma'al kafirin. Embark with us, come aboard, climb the ship, just come aboard the ship, wa la takum ma'al kafirin, and don't be from amongst the kuffar. You were making fun of me when I was building the ship. You said that there's not a drop of water, where is the ship going to go? And now you can see, you're witnessing the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَفَارَتْ النُّورِ. You can see water gushing out from every crack and every crevice. You can see water coming from the heavens. The heavens have been cleft asunder, and water is gushing from the heavens as well. You're seeing the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please come aboard the ship. وَلَا تَكُمْ مَعَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And don't be from amongst the kuffar. Don't be from amongst the kuffar. But his son foolishly replies. And this was because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed this for him. And hidayah was not written for the son of Nooh alayhi salatu wa salam. He replies, قَالَ سَآوِي إِلَى جَبَلٍ يَعْصِمُنِي مِنَ الْمَاءِ. He says, Father, I will take myself to a mountain. I will climb upon a mountain, and that mountain will save me from the water. Here we just mentioned that the waves were like mountains, and he's telling his father, I will climb this particular mountain and I'll be safe. Don't worry about me. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam cries out, قَالَ لَا عَاصِمَ الْيَوْمَ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمْ. He says, my son, la asim al yawm. Today there is no escape. No one can save you. You don't have any savior. No mountain will save you. Min amrillah, from the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the decree of Allah azza wa jal, illa man rahim, except the ones whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed His mercy upon. Whilst they were having this conversation, وَحَالَ بَيْنَهُمَا الْمَوْجُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ. Whilst they were having this conversation, whilst he was attempting to scale the mountain, and when Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam informed him that there is no escape today, a wave came across the two and he drowned. The son of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam drowned. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, witnessing this emotional and sad spectacle, he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ونادها نوح ربه فقال رب إن ابني من أهلي وإن وعدك الحق وأنت أحكم الحاكمين.
Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he cries unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O my Lord, verily my son is of my family. Inna bini min ahli. My son is of my family. Because what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala state earlier? You and your family both the ship. You and your family both the ship. But Allah said, those who believe. Only those who believe. So Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he cries out, Ya Allah, my son, he is my family. Wa inna wa'daka al-haq. And your promise is true. وَأَنْتَ أَحْكَمُ الْحَاكِمِينَ. And you are the most just of the judges. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then replies,
قَالَ يَا نُوحُ إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ.
O Nooh, surely he is not of your family. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ.
إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٍ.
Verily, his work, his a'mal, what he has done, is not that of a righteous nature. What he has done is wrong.
فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ.
And do not ask me of that which you do not have any knowledge of. فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ.
إِنِّي أَعِذُكَ أَن تَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَاهِلِينَ.
I admonish you, lest you become one of the ignorant ones. Allahu Akbar. Because what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala state very much earlier?
وَلَا تُخَاطِبْنِي فِي الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِنَّهُمْ مُغْرَقُونَ.
Do not intercede on behalf of any of them, the ones who have oppressed, the ones who have disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
إِنَّهُمْ مُغْرَقُونَ.
Indeed, they are what? They are going to drown. This was what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated earlier. So the minute Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he realizes what he just said, and then he cries to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِكَ أَنْ أَسْأَلَكَ مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِهِ عِلْمٍ وَإِلَّا تَغْفِرْ لِي وَتَرْحَمْنِي أَكُمْ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ.
Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he cries out, Ya Allah, I seek refuge with you from asking you that of which I have no knowledge. I seek refuge, I seek protection in you, Ya Allah. And unless you forgive me, if you don't forgive me now and have mercy on me, I will definitely be from the losers. He realizes what he said was wrong, and he cries unto Allah, Ya Allah, forgive me. What I have said is wrong, and I have no knowledge. I have no knowledge of all of these matters, so forgive me. If you don't forgive me, I will be of the losers. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lasted for 150 days. The punishment of Allah Azza wa Jalla. In other words, water kept gushing forth from the heavens and the earth for a period of 150 years. After 150 days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the earth.
وَقِيلَ يَا أَرْضُ ابْلَعِي مَاءَكِ وَيَا سَمَاءُ أَقْلِعِي وَغِيضَ الْمَاءُ وَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the earth, O earth, swallow up your water.
وَقِيلَ يَا أَرْضُ ابْلَعِي مَاءَكِ.
O earth, swallow up your water. وَيَا سَمَاءُ, O heavens, أَقْلِعِي وَغِيضَ الْمَاءُ. O heavens, withhold your rain. Withhold your rain. وَغِيضَ الْمَاءُ, and the water diminished. The water, you know, receded. The water levels came down.
وَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ,
and the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was fulfilled. In other words, the disbelievers were all destroyed. They had all drowned during the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وَاسْتَوَتْ عَلَى الْجُودِ.
And now the ship of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, it rested upon a mountain known as Mount Judi. Wastawat ala al-Judi. The ship of Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, it rested upon a mountain known as Mount Judi. Now in regard to the location, demographic location of Mount Judi, some historians and some scholars state that it was in the lands of Arabia, some say in Syria, some say in Turkey. Books of history mention different locations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best as to where this particular mountain is exactly located. So after the ship came to a stop on Mount Judi, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, this incident as well, books of history mention it. Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam, he sent a pigeon. He sent a pigeon out to fly around and come back. The pigeon after some time returned to Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam with leaves from the olive tree. Leaves from the olive tree in its beak. The minute Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam saw that, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam knew that the water had receded and now it was safe for them to descend from the ship. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed unto Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam,
قِيلَ يَا نُوحُ اهْبِطْ بِسَلَامٍ مِنَّا وَبَرَكَاتٍ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَىٰ أُمَمٍ مِّمَّنْ مَعَكَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O Nuh, get down from the ship, come down from the ship, بِسَلَامٍ مِنَّا, with peace from us, وَبَرَكَاتٍ عَلَيْكَ, and may blessings be upon you, وَعَلَىٰ أُمَمٍ مِّمَّنْ مَعَكَ, and on the people who are with you. With peace from us and with our blessings, you may now disembark. You may descend from the ship. May peace and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon you, as well as the people with you, the nations with you. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as we wrap off, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam is known as the second father of mankind. He is known as the second father of mankind. Because like we mentioned in the previous session, his family tree, basically the lineage, goes through Idris alayhi salatu wasalam, Sheith alayhi salatu wasalam, and Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. So obviously Adam alayhi salatu wasalam had other children. Adam alayhi salatu wasalam had other children, and their families, in other words, their generations were the generations who disbelieved in Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. So they were all destroyed. So the believers, the few believers who were with Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, were most of his family members, like cousins, grandchildren, etc., they were all very closely connected to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. So from this we understand, after this particular incident, after this punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the children of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, they spread through the lineage of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, because the rest were all destroyed. The other children were all destroyed by the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So historians mention that the Arabs, their family tree leads up to Sam, who was one of the sons of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, whilst the Abyssinians and the Syrians and the other people of that area, their family tree goes up to Ham, and the Turks, Romans and Persians, their lineage, their family tree goes up to Yafuth, as we mentioned earlier. And also some scholars state that Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Gog and Magog, even their family tree per se, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from them, their lineage also leads up to Yafuth, this particular son of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Now this, we don't have conclusive evidence to prove all of this. These are mentioned in the books of history, and I thought of sharing it with you all. So with that, we conclude today's session, and insha'Allah ta'ala, for tomorrow's session, we will be talking about the Prophet Hud alayhi salatu wasalam. So until we meet tomorrow, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, accept our good deeds, and may He azza wa jal unite us all in the gardens of Jannah with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Ameen wa akhir da'wa, yani alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakumullah khair.